Welcome. My name is Sally of Hout Scout, and we are continuing our Hautepreneur series that showcases fearless females who aren't afraid to take risks to achieve greatness. Today I'm here with Kate Butler of Flipping Moons, who's going to tell us about her adventure in taking her family around the world. Welcome, Kate.
Thanks so much, Sally. So nice to be here.
We are so excited to hear about the journey that your family has taken thus far. Can you tell us what led you to the stage that you're at?
Oh, gosh, I feel like it's been a long time in the making. Where to start? My husband and I have both been traveling for a long time, and we were just kind of curious souls. So before we got married, we backpacked quite a bit through Central and South America. And then we kind of found ourselves toddling along this little blueprint that we all know really well, right? You get your education, you get married, you buy a house, you have your kids. And we were kind of doing that and ticking the boxes and feeling actually just less and less satisfied, which was really shocking to us. So I guess the short answer was that we had kind of met a lot of goals, but still weren't feeling that stoked on life. So we took a big step back and thought, how could we do this a little bit differently? And how could we bring some adventure back in? So that's kind of the broad stroke of what led us here.
So tell us, what jobs did you leave? What were you doing before?
I have a master's in counseling psychology. So I had finished grad school a few years ago and was working as a youth and family counselor. And I was enjoying that job for sure. I was just working part-time because I had two little baby girls at home, so balancing that. And then my husband, he is an engineer, and he was working for a company that manufactures airplanes in Victoria, BC. So we were working away. We were working hard and enjoying parts of it, but also just finding that our life was mainly around waiting for weekends and holidays, and that wasn't that exciting for us anymore.
What are the names and ages of your children?
Yeah, so we have two little girls. They are, gosh, the youngest just turned two. Her name is Arwen Genevieve Butler. And then our oldest is Nola, and she's three. So Nola Louise Butler is her name. Yeah, they're fiery little things. And gosh, traveling with kids is an interesting adventure. Luke and I, my husband, often laugh about how you have these expectations and visions of what it's going to be like in different countries and, you know, oh, it'll be easier once we're here, once we're there. And then we realize, like, you're still parents and you still have to go grocery shopping and make food and do the whole routine. And it's fabulous, but it's kind of hilarious learning moments that we have all the time.
Well, it looks adorable scrolling through your Instagram. What was the scariest thing? So you quit your job. Did you freak out? How did you get the courage to do that?
Yeah, that's such a good question. We kind of did freak out. We had just been talking about it for so long, and I honestly think we were annoying ourselves, you know, complaining about the everyday grind, not having enough money to do what we want, you know. It was just a whole lot of kind of dissatisfaction. So, and then the interesting thing was we had planned and we were trying to come up with these different business ideas and how can we make this work, mapping out different strategies, trying different things. And we realized, like, we're not actually getting anywhere while we're still working our regular jobs. Like, we don't have this bank of time that we could just tap into to make a plan that would make this all work. So we realized, like, we just need to jump off and give it a try. And I think the question, this is what I always come back to, the question that really helped us take the leap was, what is the worst case scenario? And are we willing to tolerate that? And I just think once we got to that point, it was easy. So worst case scenario, we spend all our money and we have to come back home and get a job. And we realize, well, that's kind of what we're doing right now. We have no money and we're working at jobs. So we thought, well, let's give it a go, right? So I think it was just trusting in ourselves, trusting that,
you know, things will work out, and letting go of this idea that you have to have this beautifully, you know, laid out plan before you make the decision.
I can relate to that. I think naming the fear suddenly makes it so much less scary. Like you were saying, you know, just coming back home and getting back to work. So that's where we are right now.
Yeah. And I mean, I think there's big fear, and I'm sure it's the same for people without kids, but for us with little kids, there's fear around stepping outside of what's normal and what we've kind of been told is the right thing to do, the safe thing to do. So, you know, traveling around with kids, going to countries that, you know, not everybody is necessarily comfortable going to, it was tricky to kind of just stick to our gut about what we wanted and that what we felt good about. There's a lot of fear that other people carry, and it comes out through their questions and their concerns, and it's usually out of love, but it's also out of fear as well. So just sticking to what we know and what we're confident in helped. But for sure, like, having little kids added a layer of question and insecurity, I suppose, but we push through, and we have to face that every day, right? The biggest question that's coming to light these days is school, right? Our oldest is 3 years old, and everybody's asking, oh, so what are you going to do about school? Are you going to stop traveling once, you know, Nola goes to school? And it's just such an interesting question, because there's so many families that are educating their children in different ways, travel being one of them, and we're really open to learning about those different options.
And so tell us, what is Flipping Moons, your blog that chronicles your family's travels and journey? What's the vision there?
Flipping Moons is, the site itself is a blog, and I kind of describe it as like a traveling family lifestyle blog. So we're talking about the nitty gritty logistical things, like how do we actually do it? What do we pack? What does it look like with little kids? What's awesome? What's not awesome? I really like to share the truthful version, because I know online we often get this really pretty polished account of people's lives, and I'm trying to give a bit more balance through my writing. We're also exploring some ideas around minimalism and how we relate to stuff and to material goods. I think most people who travel on like a pretty regular or full-time basis really have to think about their stuff and how they consume and what they're actually going to do with their things and how to make choices around their things. So this was an interesting obstacle for us, because as we settled into kind of being, you know, late 20s into our 30s, and we owned all these things, that we had to go through this process of getting rid of our things so that we could have the ease of travel and also not the financial burden of maintaining things at home. So on the blog, I touch on ideas around minimalism with family as well. So it's really a platform to inspire other travelers and also inform them a little bit about what this kind of life would be like. So, and then through Instagram, I mean, I love Instagram as a visual way of just sharing fun snippets of life. And it's been such a cool way to connect with other travelers around the world who are doing really neat things too.
Agreed. And so tell us more. I mean, how are you affording this? How are you figuring out ways to make money as you go?
Yeah, I love that question, because that's what everybody's wondering. And it's like, I find it really refreshing when people just ask it, because it's like, that's what I'm curious when I meet other travelers, like, how do you do this? And we always begin by saying, no, we are not independently wealthy. We are not just like tapping into this big bank of cash, although wouldn't that be nice? Yeah, seriously. But, you know, we have like a whole bunch of different ways that we're making money right now. It's not this simple, straightforward system. I mean, ultimately, that would be the goal. But at this point, there's a bunch of different pieces. So for one, my husband was really fortunate to have some contract work offered to him after he left his job. So he does a little bit of remote work relating to kind of engineering and project management stuff, which is great. And then for me, I have a few different things. Just right before our call, I wrapped up an Etsy order. I have an Etsy shop, actually. So I get to create some jewelry, and I sell a little bit of that to people here and there. So that's a fun piece. And I have an online counseling practice. So I talk to some clients through video, telephone, email, or live chat. So that's a little piece of it as well. And then the kind of newest piece that I'm adding, I'm developing some e-courses. So based on what I've learned as a youth and family counselor, I'm kind of packaging some things together to make it more accessible for parents to get some support for things that might be going on in the family. So right now there's pieces trickling in from each of those streams. But like I said, it's patchy and definitely not as reliable as a in-person 9-to-5 job. So that's kind of the trade-off at this point. But we're just trying to trust that things will continue to unfold. And I think a big part of it is just being mindful of where we're living, right? Like making our choices of where to travel next based on the money that's coming in. So those two have to go hand in hand for sure.
Sounds like a very creative cobbling together of a lot of great passion projects. What's your take on the buzz there is around, you know, we live in the most connected society ever, given the internet and social media, and yet we're still the loneliest people, or we're becoming even more lonely as a society. What are your thoughts on that around how you connect with clients or consumers or family?
I think about that a lot. And actually, the course that I'm developing is, the title is literally From Tech to Connect, How to Support Parents Managing Technology in the Home. So it's about that exact question of people in relationship are feeling disconnected, yet through globalization and social media, it's incredible how we can connect across continents. So it's such an interesting situation. And then, of course, as parents who are connected and working online who have young little toddlers, we have to be so mindful of how we're working and how we're behaving and how we're modeling to our children. When I hear your question, I think absolutely, I believe that people are actually quite disconnected from one another, and we're finding a lot of fulfillment through our online connections, which I get, right? I actually get that. I felt it as I started my Flipping Moons account. I wasn't really fully bought into social media yet, so I just knew that this is a good strategy, this is a good way to kind of get connected. And then I started to build relationships with families and other travelers, and I thought, like, holy smokes, I actually get this. This is fun. This is inspiring and interesting. So I think that we have to find ways to manage it and take good care of our relationships that are right in front of us physically. And I think it's really hard, to be honest. So we have to be mindful of it every single day and try to find some kind of balance. Because, I mean, this online world is to our advantage. It's here to stay, and we can also tap into it and make it work for us. But we have to find a way to also not lose those really meaningful, tangible, right in front of us connections. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love those thoughts around mindful use and modeling for younger generations, how to use it well.
Mm-hmm. It's so hard. Oh, my gosh. And, you know, like I sometimes read my course and I'm writing as if I have it all figured out, and I don't. Like, half the time I think my work is that I'm putting out for clients is also the work that I need to do myself, right? Like, really thinking about how to put structure around it, how to keep it in check when, like, of course it's great for your engagement if you're always online, but is that great for your kids? Probably not. So it's give and take, and with every choice there's a cost. And yeah, but being mindful, knowing what we're choosing instead of just kind of floating through and not realizing what our choices come with.
Mm-hmm. So where have you traveled so far? What have been your favorite places?
So we're kind of adopting a slow travel philosophy. So, you know, before we had kids, my husband and I ripped around like really fast, kind of like young backpacker style, where 2 or 3 days here, hop on a train or a plane or head somewhere else. And we just can't do that with little ones. So our framework is to spend about 3 months or so in a location and really try to get to know the culture a little bit, let the kids settle, feel like they know the place, know the way, their way around. So our first stop was to a city right in the middle of Mexico called Guanajuato. And it's about, if you were driving, it'd be about 4 hours north of Mexico City. And this was a phenomenal place to go. I honestly had, we hadn't even heard of it about a year ago, just through our research. We just think we've found a little gem, and it's not going to be undiscovered for long. We've seen people buzzing about the city, and we spent 3 months there, right in the historical center, and loved it. We had a Spanish tutor, and the girls just kind of sunk right into the culture and the community, and so that was a really nice way to kick it off. And then we came back to BC this summer. So we're from British Columbia, but we came back to BC to a different place. So rather than being on Vancouver Island, which is where we lived before, we spent the summer right in the middle of BC in kind of a rural property. Actually, that's where I am right now. I'm looking out the window, seeing my little girl run around picking crab apples off the tree. It's really sweet. So we spent 3 months here, and then in a couple of days we're going to Spain, to Valencia. So we're going back to city, a little bit more modern city, and we'll spend 3 months there. So we're just kind of kicking off this lifestyle. We haven't been around too much yet with kids, but so far so good.
Love the slow travel approach where you really get to know a place. The more I travel, the more I realize that I need more time to really sink in and experience it.
Yeah, no, I hear you. Like, I used to like that, the kind of bucket list, check it off idea. I mean, maybe not consciously, but I found myself doing that. Like, okay, cool, I've seen this place, I've seen that place. And I don't know, it's exhausting. And I don't even really know if you're getting a true sense of a place, right?
Exactly. So yeah. What has been the most difficult or most ridiculous situations you found yourself in while traveling around with your family and trying to immerse yourself in a new culture?
Oh, gosh. There's been a few. There's been a few, like, funny ones. There's been a few absolutely horrible ones. So we've already kind of experienced quite a bit. One story I'm happy to share is about scorpions in Mexico. I'll start by saying I've been to Mexico many, many times. I've never seen a scorpion. Nobody even talked about them. And so I must have been staying in places that were just so touristy, so sprayed out, that because, you know, tourists, especially Canadians and probably Americans too, are not used to seeing scorpions, at least. Maybe Southern Americans are, but anyway. So we were a bit surprised to discover that our house had a ton. I think my husband took care of, I should say, probably like 15 scorpions. So anyway, within the first couple of days of being there, sure enough, I got stung. And that was a bit, I can laugh about it now, but it was a bit terrifying when it happened.
That sounds terrifying.
Yeah. I mean, it was all fine. They weren't the ones that can kill you, thank God. But we didn't know that, right? I had no idea what would happen. So, but it was one of those moments that I very quickly could laugh about and also find gratitude in that, for one, if my kids got stung, I would know what it felt like and not be too scared. But I'm of course glad it was me and not anybody else. But certainly gave me the heebie-jeebies for a while.
I would bet.
And then to be honest, like, there's things that happen with little kids, they're gonna happen anywhere. You know, my littlest fell off a chair and cut her head really badly in Mexico. It just broke my heart. So we were in the hospital. Yeah, we were in the hospital a few times. They got sick. You know, it was just, it's gonna happen anywhere, and we had to keep kind of telling ourselves that, because I think what happens easily is you start to question yourself and question your choices and wonder, like, what the hell are we doing? Why are we here? You know, and it's things, my mom was so sweet. Actually, I called my mom upset one day when my daughter had fallen, and she said, you know, kids fall off chairs in Canada too. There's nothing different about chairs in Mexico than in Canada. And it was such a funny and, like, honest response that really helped put things in perspective. Like, toddler, you're going to have issues, and you are, no matter where you go, things are going to happen, and it's just life, and you have to find a way to embrace them and find growth and find a way to just get through it, right?
And so what's the vision for the future? What do you hope to create or accomplish with your lifestyle?
Yeah, that's a tough one because, gosh, and where I get stuck is that I've heard myself before say, oh, this is what we want to do. This is where we want to be. And then a year later, we're kind of doing something totally different. So what I'm trying to embrace is just that we don't really know. We're gonna do this as long as it feels good. So this idea of slow travel, a few months here, a few months there, you know, there's some places I've never been to that I really want to go. You know, I've never been to Southeast Asia. You know, there's a lot of places that I just envision myself just hanging out with my babes. And I really want to do that, but I'm also not against settling down too. So we'll just see. We have to see how the kids manage and see how we can get income coming in and just be really open to different possibilities. I think perfect world, my absolute perfect vision would be to have a small little tiny home base somewhere in British Columbia. And then that would be a bit of a launching pad. So we could kind of make a space feel like home. So when we were craving that sense of home, we could come back to it and then go on adventures, even for 3 or 4 months at a time, but knowing that we have this place to come back to. I like that idea. And I think that might be helpful for the kids, but we'll see. At this point, we don't have that. So right now we're just straight up vagabonding.
Embracing the unknown. I know that's the hardest first step for a lot of people who take that leap into entrepreneurship or a new lifestyle. Do you have any advice that you would share for other aspiring families or individuals?
Well, like you said, like just noticing that it's super uncomfortable to not know and to not have a plan. But this idea that like we don't really know anyway. I don't know if I came across this notion just really laid out really beautifully in, do you know Pema Chodron?
No.
You probably do, Sally. Okay, well write her down, check her out. She's
okay.
A writer and philosopher and a lot of like Buddhist principles. And she talks about that this idea of having a plan and stability and certainty is just kind of false anyway. We don't actually have any certainty at all in life. We spend a lot of time establishing ourselves so that we feel safe and comfortable, but ultimately we're not. So she says, and of course she says it much more eloquently than I am, but she says like when you feel that uncertainty and fear, just notice that you're actually kind of coming into contact with real life. Like it is uncertain. It is scary. So I guess my advice would be, notice when you're kind of uncomfortable and stressed and scared and not sure of the plan and like, just let it be. It's okay. It's okay to feel anxious. It's okay to feel stressed. Gosh, like at the beginning of each time we go away, I feel super stressed. Like right now we're packing. I'm anxious. I know for the first week in Spain, I'm going to be trying to get my bearings, trying to figure out like what's what. What do I do if I need help? Like we don't speak Spanish very well, right? So that's just okay. So recognizing the anxiety and the fear and the fact that not knowing is just you being really in touch with reality. We don't know.
It sounds a lot like Brené Brown with the every act of courage requires vulnerability, and accepting that can be really empowering.
Yeah, exactly. Like we don't need to come up with this plan to make us feel like we've got it all figured out. Because realistically, if you're trying a different way of life, you don't have it figured out. There is no blueprint. There is no guarantee that this is going to feel good. And that's what we always say. Like we reserve the right to change our minds. Like we're not saying this is who we are forever and we're always going to be traveling. We might find that this sucks down the road. And that's okay. We can change our minds. And, you know, as long as you're confident that you can make a change, you're not locking yourself into anything. So I don't know. I think our biggest piece of advice would be embracing the unknown. You know, not being too afraid of going against that blueprint that we're spoon fed from day one. Right. Like it works for some people. I'm not anti owning a house and traditional school like that. That's great for some people, but it might not be great for everybody. So be willing to push yourself and connect with people out there. Like, one of the beautiful things of social media is, like, you will find other families or other travelers who are doing the same thing you are, who have the same fears that you do. And it's so comforting to connect with people who are on the same page. Gosh, for me, it was so normalizing. I met families with more kids than me doing way more adventurous stuff. And I was like, oh, I'm good. I'm fine. I'm not crazy, you know? Whereas if I didn't do that, I would be the only one that I knew who would be doing this with kids. And if you go by that, then it's kind of stressful. But if you get connected, then it's incredibly normalizing and supportive. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, building a community can make everything feel so much better.
Totally.
And so what are you most excited about for Valencia?
Oh, gosh. I'm thinking right now, because it's just, even you asking me that, I'm like, oh, yeah, we're going. Like, I find I'm not even really there until I'm there, so it's hard to imagine. But I think, like, I really love lively, colorful cultures. I find I'm just so drawn to the music and dancing and food and parties. Like, I just love that places are open all night. You know, not that with kids we can even really tap into that, but, you know, I just love, like, the fun, energetic, loving, passionate vibe. So I want to get back in that for sure. I want to be around action. I want to hear Spanish too. I really love the language. Yeah, so I think those things, the energy, the color, the language, and also just kind of being with my little family. There's something about traveling with just the four of us that we just kind of get in this little bubble of learning and growth, and I am ready to kind of retreat into that little bubble together.
And is it ever too much together time, or is it always so good?
No, it's 100% too much. No, it's not all the time, but it's, yeah, like, that's one of the things we're trying to figure out, because it has nothing to do with how much I love my husband and kids. It's just, like, we are all individual human beings and we need some time. So, yeah, like, it's tricky. That's one of the things we have to figure out. I'm already saying to my husband, like, as soon as we get there, I'm finding a yoga studio. I'm going to, oh, actually today I just got joined up with a mom group in Valencia, which I'm really excited about. Maybe I'll make some.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Maybe I'll make some friends. And so, yeah, we have to figure out a way to get some time alone. And also my husband and I together, we hired a nanny. Actually, this is a big tip. Find some childcare right away. We hired an awesome babysitter in Mexico, and it was just like, just for, I think it was, what was it? 10 hours. 15 hours a week, so Luke and I could go and work or go have coffee, whatever, but just get away, and it was huge. It made all the difference, so everybody needs that space, but your question is right on.
Yes, pro tip, hire a nanny a little bit.
Yeah, right away, first thing.
So good. And anything else you want to share with our listeners before we sign off?
I don't know. I guess, I mean, I feel excited talking right now. I feel like it's exciting talking about the fear and the fun and the challenges. Like, it's real life, right? A lot of people ask or kind of talk to us as if we're on this, you know, permanent vacation. And it's just not that. It's actually harder is what I've learned. It's harder than life before, than a more of a traditional life. But we're choosing to do it still, and that's the biggest indicator that it's worth it. So mm-hmm. with the challenge comes the good, and we're learning so much, and it's fun. It's really fun. So we would encourage families to go for it. Give it a try. I don't think you'll regret it.
Sometimes harder is more fulfilling. Well,
yeah.
Thank you so much, Kate. It's been wonderful catching up with you. And
you too, Charlie. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. And tell our listeners where they can find you online.
Yes. So you can find me at flippingmoons.com. That's my blog. So you can send me a message on there. You can check out some of the articles. And also on Instagram. So flippingmoons is my Instagram handle as well. And you get to see some pics of our adventures. So we'll be sure to get some new ones up of Spain and show you guys where we're staying and what's all good there. So thanks for tuning in, and hopefully we will connect with some of you guys down the road.